The Aegis and the Monado. Both blades easily represent their games, and so that begs the question, which is better, Xenoblade Chronicles 1 or Xenoblade Chronicles 2? And by doing so, we will comprehensively decide which entry in Nintendo's flagship JRPG series is the best. I'm Tagigarin, and this is the War of the Xenoblade. Also, just before we begin, just so it's fair, I'll be using the Switch version of Xenoblade Chronicles, just so they both have the same successful console to throw their stats off.
Sales.
Well, to start things off, we should do the only one that's an undeniable fact. I wanted to do the first year sales exactly, but for some reason, Nintendo doesn't keep the most important data regarding a game. Starting with Xenoblade Chronicles 2, it has sold 1.73 million copies worldwide through March 2019. That news comes from straight from Monolith Soft's Tetsuya Takahashi, who shared the news in a crossover interview with Bandai Namco's Katsuhiro Harada. Takahashi indicated that sales are essentially peaking at that number, which makes sense given how the RPG has been out for quite some time. That's very good, but can the original do better? Nintendo reveals that Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition had sold a total of 1.32 million copies just after 1 month on the market. That's just 1 month. So what does a year tell us? Well, I can't exactly find it on first look, so I went digging and it had sold 1.52 million by February 2021, which does mean that the first point goes to Xenoblade Chronicles 2. Visuals. This category is why I didn't use the Wii version of Xenoblade 1. Both games have the same amazing visuals, but different art styles. Xenoblade Chronicles 1 has a more realised art style with nice clean graphics, but this is a definitive edition, and speaking with Famitsu as translated by Nintendo Everything, director Tetsuya Takahashi confirmed that the budget and time constraints prevented the developer from remaking everything, and so they started taking things one step at a time. Starting from the texture upscaling, adding shader textures to enemies and maps, and proceeding to character models. He then says this quote, "Then we remade things like the main and important characters' faces and hands, the new equipment in the Definitive Edition, the Monado, the facial animations, during cutscenes and scripted events, and so on." Even though we divided things up like this, before long, each member of the team began showing their passion and abilities, so we wound up incidentally touching things up like NPCs and enemies that we didn't intend on changing initially. Xenoblade Chronicles 2, however, has a more anime-like art style, which gave the directors more liberties with how they could animate certain parts, and so it makes certain parts more satisfying to see, and so it's hard to say which is better on the visuals department, but I will have to give it to Xenoblade Chronicles 2, just due to personal preference. Supporting cast. Both games have the best supporting cast I've seen from JRPGs in a very long time, and so deciding which game has the better cast was really, really tough. The main cast of both games are incredibly fleshed out throughout their stories, but I think Xenoblade Chronicles 2 cast is a lot more immediately likeable thanks to being able to view all the heart-to-hearts without needing affinity requirements. The main issue I have with Xenoblade Chronicles 1 cast, however, is its lack of good side/supporting characters. Yes, you have Dunban and Ricky, but it feels like every time you start a new chapter, you're introduced to a bunch of new supporting characters who are usually pretty cool, but by the end of the chapter, the game kind of just forgets about them or kills them. Overall, both games have great stories with fantastic main characters, but I think Xenoblade Chronicles 2 supporting cast is way better than Xenoblade Chronicles 1's.
Lifesaver! Oh yeah, baby!
So, yeah, I know I'm doing more intermissions recently, but I like to use these as ways to talk about the future instead of cramming them in the outro, because most people won't watch the outro. So, my next plan is to do next week's video be a One Piece video. And for that, I would recommend following my Twitter, so I will be posting more on plans and stuff. There are polls on my Twitter as well, which will be important to videos. But also, I will make an announcement video soon, announcing something, I'm not sure. But yeah, apart from that, let's go back to the video.
Zeke, you're a lifesaver. Who wants a piece of us? Oh yeah, baby!
Main characters. Shulk's arc is learning to trust his friends. He believes that he himself can change the future. Something seen through the constant cutscenes in the Aether Mine. Which, in fairness, isn't entirely his fault. He's been given a sword that cuts through a material that no other sword does, excluding certain purchasable swords. Once we reach the Prison Island event, his issue isn't that he's weak, it's just that his sword is. As a result, he can't do everything himself and needs to rely on his friend. Shown through the whole topple sword to damage him, which requires a team to do that. On the other hand, Rex is the weak one. He relies too much on his friends. We see this in the early chapters where he recklessly uses Pyro's energy to attack, and despite how powerful she is, it doesn't leave a lasting impact on their opponent. Rex goes through the similar process as Soul. He upgrades his sword to take out a threat that he couldn't dent before, but this doesn't last. Eventually, it gets down to the point where he realises that it's his own fault, and therefore has to manage without the OP power before being rewarded with the ability to wield the Aegis again and beat the foes. In conclusion, I love both characters. They seem so similar, yet very different. I much prefer Shulk's more calm and collected personality, yet from a storytelling and gameplay perspective, Rex is much better. We go on a journey with him, improving alongside him as a player. And once we learn to manage without the OP blade we're relying on, the point will have to go to Xenoblade Chronicles music. Both games have phenomenal soundtracks with the same composers for both, so talent doesn't choose the victor here, it is just the actual pieces themselves and how they sound and work within the context of the game. Xenoblade 1 got to take a lot more liberty with its soundtrack, as it was totally different to a lot of the JRPG series, as I went for some slightly more hardcore music. You will know our names and engage the enemy, just name a couple, and the music is just soothing to the ears, even out of the game, just normally, it's simply sublime. Xenoblade 2, however, also has good music, with the more arcane ways themed. It also has amazing music, but it does try to stick with a cohesive theme, with it taking a more cutesy anime-like style, which isn't to its own detriment. Actually, it helps the music, as it just makes it even more potent to the ears and allows it to be heard way more smoothly and comfortably. But we will have to pick a winner, and due to reviewing the Switch versions, I will have to pick Xenoblade Chronicles 1, because the remastered music and Future Connector's battle theme just simply win it for me. Setting. So some of you may be asking what I mean by setting, and basically it's just the world. I didn't really want to put world, but I don't know really. But both games are quite level in this department. I'll have to keep this brief, but if you want a slightly more in-depth look at the worlds, please check out my reviews on both games, as cringy as they are. Xenoblade Chronicles 1 has the Bionis and the Mechonis. We are given lore as to how the world is throughout the game, and it works within the narrative, but Future Connected is slightly wreck on this, but on the whole, the world is absolutely phenomenal and gives us some amazing sights. Whereas Xenoblade Chronicles 2 is set in Allrest, which also works in its pre-established lore, we will say that it does a lot more to make us question its continuity, which says a lot about Future Connected, as it screws with the continuity so much. But it's still very nice and works for the narrative it's trying to tell. So the point is going to have to go to Xenoblade Chronicles 1, although it was very close and could have been different if the continuity of either game was better. So we are stuck on 3 apiece, and we can't have end on the draw. So I sent out a Twitter poll earlier this week, and well, yes, as you can see, 6 votes. I'm not that popular on Twitter, so please follow. And they decided that Xenoblade Chronicle 1 was better, so Xenoblade Chronicle 1 wins. I know it's not much of a ceremonious victory, but my fans decided so, so that's what I'll be. Some of you may be asking which one I prefer, and to answer that I say this. They are both phenomenal games, but Xenoblade Chronicles 1 slightly edges out for me. Stylistically and narratively, it's stronger and shows how good it is since it originally released on Wii. So that's going to be it for today. Do you agree with my judgment? Let me know down below. I'm sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Man, self-promo is rough, but yeah, apart from that, thank you so much for watching.
What's that?
Get off me! To you!
Right in the... Take this, bubble! That's good.